Hello students, today we shall discuss what do we mean and what do we understand by inclusive classrooms. How do we create inclusive classrooms and what exactly is included in the creation of an inclusive classroom? What are the different strategies which I may use to create an inclusive classroom? So let us go into the details and find out how a teacher can create an inclusive classroom. Because for the cause of inclusive education, it is very important for us to understand that how should we create an inclusive classroom. See, systematically done, it is possible to include the children in regular classes. Possible to include children, it means all the children, irrespective of their gender, irrespective of their religion, irrespective of their disability, irrespective of the region they represent, irrespective of their socioeconomic lag, whether the child is suffering from or has a disability, whether the child is able, that's not the criteria. If it's a child, that child is there in my classroom and it is my duty to provide for that child. The earlier efforts with respect to inclusion were not sufficient and we need to really work very hard with reference to achieving inclusive education in letter and spirit. It is ideal to have resource rooms in every elementary school with a competent resource person. It is very, very important. In a resource room and organizing a resource room, it is not that difficult as we think. Now, if there are children with special needs, with the available resources, it is very, very important that certain key points are kept in mind to cater to the needs of the children in a classroom. For example, there may be children with learning disabilities. Okay, and there are parental concerns and the competencies of the teacher. All these have to be taken care of. And it is very, very important that every teacher has an updated profile of every child so that the teacher is aware with reference to the needs which the teacher needs to cater to with respect to each child in the classroom. Now, when you talk of what are the different ways I can create an inclusive classroom, let us look at the different means with respect to classroom adjustment and management. Firstly, it is very, very important that advanced planning for teaching is undertaken. A teacher needs to be well planned with reference to delivery of the lesson in a classroom, with reference to engaging in the kind of activities in the classroom, with reference to the use of teaching learning materials in the classroom. There has to be a coordination between the class teacher, counselors, parents, resource teachers, others, depending on the needs of the child. It will depend if your classroom has a child who has hearing impairment, you may need at times the support of an audiologist, right? Therefore, you have to be very, very clear with the profile of the child which you have, that what are the needs of the child. Then teaching has to be such that it caters to individual needs. We cannot do this that we neglect some children in the classroom and cater to the majority. No, every child in the class is there for me to see that I cater to the needs of the child. Another very, very important strategy which we may use, which is really very helpful for teaching in groups, is cooperative learning and peer tutoring. Okay, we will go into the details of what exactly is cooperative learning and what exactly is peer tutoring. Then we have use of appropriate teaching learning materials. It's not just about teaching learning materials. We also have to decide which is the teaching learning materials which are the most appropriate for my class. I, as a teacher, need to decide after careful thought which are the teaching learning materials which I may use in my class to teach all the children. So this is, and then documentation is also important. One, I document the needs of the different children. I also document the progress of the different children. And apart from documenting the needs and the progress, I also need to document the best practices, which were my best practices as a teacher, which enabled us to achieve the maximum success with children. So documentation is also very, very important, such that through that documentation, I shall be able to cater to the needs of all children in the best possible way in future too. Right. Now, let us go to the next. When we discussed what is, different strategies, I said that we can use cooperative learning and peer tutoring. Now, what exactly is cooperative learning? Cooperation, as you all know, is working together to accomplish shared goals. When we say, I'm going to cooperate with you, it means that we are going to help each other in accomplishing something. Okay? Within cooperative situations, this is the definition given by Johnson & Johnson. Within cooperative situations, individuals seek outcomes that are beneficial to themselves and to the group members. That means when a number of students are working together in groups, each individual works together in a group such that the individual is benefited with reference to the learning and the group members are also benefited with reference to the learning task. Cooperative learning is the instructional use of small groups. That is very, very important to understand that cooperative learning in a class works in small groups. You cannot make a group of the entire class and call it cooperative learning. No, you have to divide children in small groups and then only this cooperative learning as an instruction would succeed. Students work together to maximize their own and each other's learning. That means they are not only working to look at their own learning or achieve something, they are also looking at their learning of the peers in the group. So that means there is working together and there is cooperation in this group with reference to achievement of a particular task or, for example, if they are to perform a role play together, there may be a cooperative learning group working on a project together. There may be a cooperative learning group which is writing a story together, so on and so forth. So cooperative learning works best where individuals seek outcomes that are beneficial to each one of them. So this is about cooperative learning which teachers can use in the class. The second very, very important strategy which we can use in an inclusive classrooms is peer tutoring. As the name suggests, you know, there are two words here. Peer and tutoring. Peer is my comrade or my classmate who is of my age or my mental age who is with me in the class, and tutor is somebody who teaches or tutors me. So peer tutoring is a term that's been used to describe a wide array of tutoring arrangements. But most of the research on its success refers to students working in pairs. Now, in cooperative learning, we said students working in groups, right? Here we are talking of one-to-one, working in pairs to help one another learn material or practice an academic task. For example, a teacher may have given one poem to the students and, you know, both the students have to understand the poem together. So, one student may be reciting it, the other may be trying to find the meaning from the dictionaries and both of them may discuss and learn from each other in this. Peer tutoring works best when students of different abilities levels work together. That means there may be one child who may not be very proficient with reference to recitation, if we take the example of poetry, and there may be another child who may be very proficient with reference to recitation. So if you put both these two children together, they will learn from each other. So that is why the term tutoring is there, because one of them has a key role of teaching the other. And of course, both of them learn in the process. During a peer tutoring assignment, it is common for the teacher to have students switch roles partway through so that the tutor becomes the one being tutored. That means at some point of time, when I am being tutored, at another point of time, I become the tutor in the pair of students which are working together. Since explaining a concept to another helps extend one's own learning, this practice gives students the opportunity to understand better the material being studied. You must have seen, if you have something at hand and when you discuss it with your friends or your peers, don't you understand that better? Yes, you do. So it's very, very important that peer tutoring is used as an exercise where both of you learn together by working in pairs. And I am very sure that when you learn together, you learn to share, you understand each other better, and the outcome of that learning is also better. Going further, we also need to see what research says about peer tutoring. In reviews of peer tutoring programs, researchers found that when students participated in the role of a reading tutor, improvements in reading achievement occurred. That means one student was a tutor and the other was reading the material. Okay, being read or listening to the material being read, they may be switching roles in this process, but there was drastic improvement in the reading achievement of both the learners. When tutors were explicitly trained in the tutoring process, they were far more effective and the students they were tutoring experienced significant gains in achievement. That means we are also saying that tutoring requires expertise and tutoring also requires training. So once the tutor is trained with reference to the kind of training the tutor is supposed to give to the tutee, it is very, very important that when you engage a tutor or that student whom you have trained has significant experience in that, such that the learning achievement of both the students improves. Then another very important thing which research has pointed out is most of the students benefited from peer tutoring in some way or the other. But the same age, this you should note, that same age tutors were as effective as cross-age tutors. That means when there was an age difference between the tutor and the tutee, as well as when there was no age difference, they were of the same age group, in both the cases, the student achievement was same. That means the students were benefiting in both the cases, in case of cross-age tutoring and in case of same-age peer tutoring. So peer tutoring has also shown many benefits, and this should be used in an inclusive classroom. This will on one hand reduce the load of the teacher, and the second point is that it makes learning more joyful, meaningful and more engaging for the learners in the process. See, a smart teacher will effectively use peer tutoring, and the peer tutors shall help students with disabilities learn and vice versa. But this also helps children in their own learning, and of course the workload of the teacher is reduced, especially where the class size is very high. We are all aware that still in many classrooms the teacher-student ratio is higher than 1:35 or 1:40. In that case, peer tutoring may be very effective. But we have to be very, very sure in this case that the tutor is aware of the learning material and the tutor is effectively trained by the teacher with reference to the kind of training which is to be imparted and the learning material which needs to be taught. This is another benefit. A sense of responsibility towards special children is developed in children without disabilities. They feel attached to each other. They feel responsible for each other. And by seeking help and respect for their classmates who are helping and supporting them in their academics, children with disabilities also develop respect for them. So it becomes mutually a very beneficial exercise, or a symbiotic relationship between the two of them develop. One has a responsibility for teaching the other, and the other, owing to the responsibility being discharged by the child, is developing a sense of respect. So in the long run, you see that this tutor-tutee relationship flourishes and the achievement of both the children improves. And this can be used in an inclusive classroom by the teacher very effectively, provided the teacher trains the tutors in advance and the tutor-tutee relationship also flourishes. We have to be very, very careful with reference to the choice of tutor and tutee, because it is important that the two children have a cordial relationship with each other such that they learn with each other, right? Although it should be our endeavor that most of the children at some point or the other, you know, become tutor and tutees to each other, because this also enables children to understand each other and they learn to share and care for each other. And it's also very important that we understand the use of suitable teaching learning material that we call TLM and information and communication technology, that is ICT. In using that, first and foremost, it should be age appropriate. The teaching learning material which you are using has to be age appropriate. For example, 10-year-olds with a mental ability matching that of a 5-year-old children should have material suitable to his age rather than toys meant for 5-year-olds. It's very, very important. You cannot expect that child to play with toys all the time. If the child has an intellectual disability, the child needs to be taken care of and the material has to be suited, has to be well suited according to his mental ability. Then secondly, we also have to see that there is active participation. With the, you have a teaching learning material that is available, that is accessible, but active participation also has to be ensured. The student should be able to use the material, explore the material, learn from it, maneuver the material. This learning by doing exercise should make the child very versatile and also should be able to, you know, fuel the imagination of the child, allowing for a varied usage of materials creatively. So, depending upon the materials you have, depending upon the subject you're teaching or the content you're teaching, you need to understand that the materials have to be suited according to the children which you are catering to. Okay, so the suitability of the teaching learning material is very, very important when you are talking of a inclusive classroom. The use of suitable teaching learning material, and yes, as you all know, in, even in the case of information communication technology, the choice of the right technology. For example, if it's a child who learns best by the visual mode, it is very, very important that we use photographs, we use the visual modes like pictures, we may use a film, so on and so forth. Whereas there may be a child who doesn't feel very interested with reference to the audio visual aids. So in that, and is more kinesthetic in nature. In that case, you have to engage that child in hands-on activities, have a teaching learning material, give them tasks such that they engage in meaningful projects, all in problem-solving activities together, where cooperative learning can work wonderfully. Then, in an inclusive classroom, we also have to see that these teaching learning materials are easily available, are affordable, which is very important. That means they should be cost-effective. If the student has to buy the material for extended home training, this has to be seen that it is available, affordable or accessible. Because, for example, if you have a child who is visually impaired, you should have Braille, which the child may also use with reference to extended home training. Then we also have to see that whether it is of the appropriate level. The material, for example, should suit the level of the functioning of the child. For example, if it's a child with MR, you have to see that, that the teaching learning material which you are using is appropriate for the child with reference to the level of mental retardation the child is coping with. So that learning is meaningful to him or her. Now, when you see, even the language here matters a lot in an inclusive classroom. When you say him or her, that means this is a gender neutral language. We should not address to one particular group of students. We have to address to all of them, right? So, and then we talk of transfer of training. That is, use of the material should allow the child to easily generalize the concept learned to other contexts and situations. That means I've learned something today, I can use that concept in another situation. I should know where concepts can be generalized. Where can I use, for example, I'll just give you an example for mathematics. Suppose you're traveling on the road, you're in your car and you see a pole tilting. So, in mathematics, you have learned heights and distances. So, based on heights and distances, you should be able to calculate where that pole is going to fall so that you can, you know, take the precautions of not getting hit by that pole. So, this is very, very important that the transfer of training happens and children are able to learn that, okay, this is the concept, this is where I can apply it in my daily life. Then, with reference to use of ICT, information communication technology is doing wonders. It has opened a plethora of devices for us to be used and it has also gives us a lot of options. For example, apart from making teaching learning more accessible and interesting, we have ebooks and other resources available online which support learning by the click of the mouse. On the other hand, there are numerous audio, video, CDs, DVDs, online resources which may be shown to students. What the teacher can do is, teacher can ask the students to browse, or otherwise, if there's at the elementary level, the best part would be that the teacher makes a list of the websites which the students may be required to browse, and the teacher may also, you know, screen in the classroom. For that, the infrastructure has to be in place, that the LCD projector is there, that the screen is there, right? The seating arrangement is comfortable for the teachers to screen a film, right? For example, if we are teaching poetry, you may like to show them the biography of a poet. So this biography can also be screened with reference to a video CD or a DVD, right? Or biographies of great personalities. If you're, for example, if you're teaching them about the contribution of Mahatma Gandhi, or if you're teaching them with reference to the contribution of Martin Luther King, or the contribution of Mother Teresa, so on and so forth, of different histories across the world, cultures of India, civilizations, you can teach them, or by the screening of short films, or show them a video depicting, for example, this we discussed in the last class also, vocal cords. While I'm speaking, you cannot see my vocal cords, right? So when I show you a video clip wherein there is a movement of the vocal cords while a person speaks, it will definitely become very clear to you how the vocal cords work. Now, in an inclusive classroom, we also know that we have children with special needs, and we are duty bound to cater to the children with special needs as well. Use of aids and appliances for children with special needs and teaching using technology is also in vogue. It is very important. Many schools have computer lab with adaptations for children with special needs. There are talking books and computers for children who are blind. Sophisticated wheelchairs so that the child can move about freely, right? There are ramps to facilitate the child. There are educational softwares are on the increase these days. And it's also very important that I show you some of the assistive aids, which may be very useful in an inclusive classroom. Not only will they be useful, every inclusive classroom should be well equipped with the use of these teaching aids on one hand, and the assistive devices should be available all the time for the use of the child. These may be used with the help of the counselors, with the help of the audiologist, depending upon, you know, the aid which you are using or the assistive device which you are using. But it's very, very important, if we are talking of an inclusive classroom, these assistive devices should be there, right? A classroom is inclusive in the real sense of the word when it is well equipped with all the assistive devices, software, hardware, furniture, which aids different children in the classroom, such that they are comfortable with reference to learning and they feel happy when they learn. For example, look at this. This is the Braille alphabet, right? The Braille should be there in a classroom where you have children who are, who need help. They have visual impairment. So Braille should be there in this classroom such that whatever the teacher is reading, they can, that the same thing is available on Braille with respect to them. Then if you see, this is a hearing aid, right? For a child who may be suffering with a hearing impairment, we may use this hearing aid or any other hearing aid which the child may use such that the child is able to hear effectively. Another very, very important thing is that apart from the hearing aid being available, we also have to see that this child sits in the front so that the child is able to listen to what the teacher is saying and is not, does not face any difficulty, is listening to the teacher in the classroom. So that is also very, very important. Now look at this. This is a reading pen which provides the audio input of the scanned text. That means, for example, you have a textbook, the pen scans the text, okay? After scanning the text, it gives out audio input. So if a child who's visually impaired, because of this reading pen, the child is able to hear whatever is being written in the textbook. So this can be a very effective aid for a child who is visually impaired. These are number of softwares are coming, number of assistive devices are available. But it is very, very important that we make all the efforts to bring these aids, to bring these assistive devices inside the classroom. Only then can you talk of an inclusive classroom. Inclusion shall only be fostered in a classroom teaching learning situation when all of us strive together in teaching with the knowledge. We are prepared to cater to all the children of our classroom. We have the kind of skills. We are well endowed with the skills. And we are have an absolutely positive attitude towards all the children. And I take it as my duty to cater to all the students in my classroom. If all of us take a vow that we are going to do this for every child in our classroom, the day is not far where every classroom of our country will be an inclusive classroom in letter and spirit. That classroom shall have the support of different resource personnel. That classroom shall have the support of the counselor. The classroom shall have a well-equipped teacher. And this teacher will be well-equipped with reference to knowledge, skills, and attitudes to cater to the diversity of learners. And where this diversity will become an asset for each one of us. And our learners are going to learn joyfully and understand every concept such that they are able to transfer and generalize those concepts and learn from them in their daily life. I hope you have understood the meaning of an inclusive classroom, how an inclusive classroom is to be created, and the onus of responsibility you all have as future teachers on your shoulders to make every class an inclusive classroom in the long run. I wish you all the best, and may you all strive to make every class an inclusive classroom. Thank you very much.